Bingo, we're back, 2 o'clock rock here on a given Tuesday. And today we're gonna do ThinkTech Tech Talks with our chief scientist, Ethan Allen. Welcome to chief scientist.
Glad to be here, Jay. Nice to be here again.
And we thought we'd follow on a discussion that took place on 60 Minutes on CBS on Sunday night. It was about swarms of drones. So we're calling this show Drones at the Frontier. Now we do have a regular show, you know, on Friday afternoon with Ted Ralston, and it's called Where the Drone Leads. So this is, like complements that, because drones are big technology these days. In fact, let me say that drones are an accumulation, an intersection of many technologies, and I'll name the ones that come to mind. Let's see. You got material science, right, for sure. You got aeronautics, get right that. You got avionics and radio transmissions, and all kinds of things around that. Mm-hmm. You got computers and artificial intelligence right up at the foreground, and and you can take a lot of software and put it in a little tiny chip, and they do. Sensor technology, which in science, everything. Right. You've got sensors that do the most remarkable things in all areas of science, right, and certainly they're relevant in drones. And of course, last but the biggest one of all, weapons technology, right?
Well, not a necessary part of drones, but it's
certainly an intersection, and helps to fund their development. I'm sure Donald Trump will want to continue the development of drones, if for no other reason than weapons technology. And so there are lots of issues that come up, and we certainly haven't settled down on them, but I would like to discuss with you, Ethan, exactly how these various technologies and sciences are playing together, and whether we have the tiger by the tail or whether the tiger is running away from us. Because, although we don't hear about it in the newspaper, drones play a big role in battlefield experiences all over the world. And although the U.S. has Silicon Valley, a lot of smart guys with those disciplines, the fact is that people copy them and sometimes beat them. And then they do counter-drone technology, which is also relevant. And I remember reading about the Israelis. I'll tell you one very clever thing the Israelis did. They have a rope technology. And one drone flies on top of the other drone, drops a little piece of rope. Guess what? It gets caught in the rotors, and the one below goes down. Now, that's clever.
Yes, indeed. Very simple.
Very clever. Very simple, elegant, yeah. Wow. Anyway, there's all kinds of things happening now. We don't necessarily know about them. And what was revealed in the 60 Minutes piece on Sunday, 2 days ago, was that we have learned how to fly drones in swarms where they talk to each other and they are ready, autonomous. So when I say drones are the frontier, I include autonomous technology where you send them on a mission, they do the mission, and you don't really have any control. Maybe you have an override on it, but basically they do what you program them to do. Huh. This is different.
So like a flock of a dozen or 100 drones all just operating on their own. Huh?
Well, the demonstration there was that it was hundreds.
Wow.
And little ones, about that big. And they operate together. And they don't collide. And they fly like the geese, all together in a flock.
Right.
And they can do really incredible things. And if one gets knocked out for some reason, the others are still up there. Right. And they're, they're duplications of each other, except that the software makes them act as one.
Right, right.
It's very interesting.
Now, flocking technology, flocking as a strategy is a very good strategy. It's clearly widely used by fish, by birds, by a lot of different animals. It's a way to both survive when you're being hunted and also to hunt more effectively.
Being the operative word. I'm sure that'll interest Donald Trump. So if I gave you this problem scientifically, I'd be interested in how you would do it. My problem that I'm giving you, Ethan, is, how do I build software that will, A, make the drones not hit each other, not collide with themselves or anything else, and B, to fly as a flock, so that each drone is aware of not only the one next to him, but all the drones in the swarm? How do you do that?
Well, biologists have been thinking about this question for a long time. How do fish school, how do birds fly in flocks like that, that move all synchronously and all? And it turns out there are some fairly simple rules that can be used. One rule being, you never let yourself get closer than X distance to your neighbor, your nearest neighbor, basically. And if everyone sort of has that same rule, then they'll tend to, not collide, right? The other sort of counterpart to that rule is you don't ever want to be further away than X from your nearest neighbor. And so that will tend to keep them together, basically.
Yeah.
And again, if they all have this rule, they'll all be sort of jockeying, trying to stay. Ideally, of course, an animal in flock wants to stay in the center of the flock because it's safe there, basically, if you're a prey animal, right?
Yeah.
And I don't know how they set these drones up, but I'd imagine that they're doing some rules somewhat like that. I don't believe that every drone is tracking instantaneously the position of all the other drones.
Oh, I think they are. That was mentioned in the program, where each drone reads out his own position in space.
Right.
Exact position, I don't know, maybe it's a GPS.
Right.
And each drone then broadcasts its position to all the other drones. That's not radar. It's not a matter of getting too close on a radar kind of analysis.
Right.
It's a matter of all the drones know where all the other drones are. They're all tracking all the hundreds or thousands of drones. Mm-hmm. And then they make sure that they don't get too close. Mm-hmm. And that they fly together in the same direction. Mm-hmm. What I don't know, and maybe this is obvious, not to me though, is do you need to have a central brain here?
Right.
Or can you do this on a sort of collective basis, just like the geese?
Right.
Can you do it collectively?
Well, now, geese fly in Vs, and geese clearly do have a leader, and the leader typically is the sort of the senior member of the flock, the biggest, toughest goose around, because being the start of the V is the tough place to fly. You're breaking the waves for everyone else, and everyone else is riding off your turbulence, basically.
So are you telling me that these drones, say 100 drones, will sort of designate a leader, the one out in front?
Well, no, with big flocks of birds, when you watch flocks of birds that just circle and stretch out into a long flock and then collapse into a little, there is no obvious leader. And, it's a very different situation there. And, how do they make the decision? Yeah. Like, we're going to go this way, or we're going to go that way, or we're going to go up, or we're going to go down. And
it's supposed to be autonomous, right?
Right.
There's nobody down. They get a mission
to
go and do this thing, and there's nobody down on the ground controlling it, except maybe in an override. But the ordinary course, no. And so how do they act as a collective brain? Mm-hmm. This must be artificial intelligence.
Yes, and it's one of these odd sort of systems phenomena, right, where one drone or two drones wouldn't do this, but when you get enough of them together, this emergent property of apparent intelligence just comes out, and they start behaving in very sensible ways. Yeah.
I want to digress for a minute just to broaden the inquiry. Now, in this 60 Minutes, they also had a drone ship. It was a ship that was fairly narrow with pontoons. It was a ship that didn't carry anybody but had lots of weapons on it. And the Navy is actually building the ship. You can see pictures of it. And I remember, there were harbor boats, harbor defense, harbor security boats designed a few years ago. A friend of mine was actually selling them. And these guys were also drones. And you gave them a mission, patrol the harbor. And they had guns on them, and you really wondered if this was going to work or somebody was going to get murdered. Mm-hmm. But the Navy already has a ship like this, and it's not ready for prime time, but they're developing it. And then, so I take the swarm idea from the 60 Minutes piece, and I say, well, how about a fleet of ships? Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, for that matter, how about a fleet of submarines? Right. I don't know if the technology would be the same, but I think it's entirely possible.
Sure.
And how about, a fleet of things on the ground? Mm-hmm. This is out of a sci-fi movie.
Sure.
Where they're all a drone, and they're all remote, and they all have a mission, and they're all pre-programmed.
Sort of like an army of army ants, right?
Army of army ants,
I mean, they move, again, as a big coordinated swarm, basically, and are capable of doing incredible things when they get together.
We're there.
Right.
It's one thing to have all the drone technology, all the stuff, all the science coming together and all that. And I'm going to talk about the evolution of that science. But it's another thing to have a swarm of them. That's the miracle. Right.
And it's one thing to have a drone flying there with some human operator running it or at least running its weapons, letting it do a lot of local control of flying, but basically being ready to push the button. It's another thing if you turn that level of control over to the drone or the flock of drones, as it were. You've crossed an interesting line there, letting the machines make the choice to release weapons, unleash weaponry.
Those were two points. Those two points were made in the piece. Number one is this is truly disruptive technology. When you put it all together, it crosses the line now. Mm-hmm. They act together. They act on a pre-program basis. And I guess when you add into that mix, you add the fact that they can be programmed to use weapons and kill people, okay? So when you put all that together, that's really disruptive. Could change. And one guy on this piece said, this is going to change things. This is, you know, this is really going to change things. We're going to see this flower out. It's going to have a big effect, not only on the battlefield, but in everything.
Sure.
I agree with him. And let your mind fly. We can do that. The other thing is that, you know, a point you made is that these things are capable of being running autonomously and killing people. Mm-hmm. So are you going to have them kill people autonomously? Don't we need to have another human being involved in that decision before you send out? This is out of sci-fi.
Yeah.
It's a B movie. Before you send them out to kill people all by themselves, and that's pretty scary, isn't it?
You would think you'd want some human operator involved in that, because otherwise, for one, you risk the idea that if you have a good hacker, they can sort of turn them around and send them back at you.
Excellent point. And then hacking, you know, whatever you design is always subject to the possibility of hacking, and Vladimir Putin wouldn't hesitate to turn our drone army right back on us. So you shoot me, huh? I fix you, I shoot you.
Right.
Yeah, so this is gonna be, and now you can't afford, you know, to make a mistake. I remember early on in Afghanistan, there was a really funny incident about one of those aerial surveillance drones. And somebody with a part they got out of a hardware store figured out how to bring it down or change its path or neutralize it. I forget what. It was really very clever. And the enemy, you know, just neutralized our drone for us with parts from a hardware store for Don 98. They did it. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, if you had a swarm of drones and then you had an army of programmers and hackers, you could turn it around. I'm sure you could turn it around. And then what you programmed would come back on you.
And one of the issues with drones, they typically being small, they're relatively cheap to build, and the technology, while sophisticated, is now pretty widespread, which means sort of any Yahoo can start building these things, more or less. It's not like an atomic bomb that takes some serious sophistication. You need to get materials that are very hard to get. You need to, you know, have a good deal of fancy equipment. You know, you can't really build an atomic bomb in your garage, particularly.
But you can build a drone.
You can build a drone.
And you can build lots of drones. Build a swarm of drones.
Right, yeah, pretty much in your garage.
You know, we're going to the National Association Broadcaster Show in April. We went last year. Mm-hmm. And what I noticed was that there was an enormous number of drone products there. For cameras, right?
Sure.
You take video for movies and the like.
Sure.
And indeed, you save a lot of money not using a helicopter. Use a drone about that big and take, you know, brilliant photo, video. Every year, it's a bigger deal.
So instead of having fixed cameras mounted at all our intersections and buildings in the cities, I'll just have drones patrolling the cities in organized fashion. So basically, every street is being covered at all times.
Right. And so cameras, you know, cameras are a big thing. Cameras control society, observe society, give government a lot of power, whoever owns them, a lot of power. But dwelling on that and thinking we'll come back and talk about the evolution of these various, interconnecting technologies, we're going to take a short break. That's Ethan Allen. He's our chief scientist.
Hi, I'm Donna Blanchard. I'm the host of Center Stage, which is on Wednesdays at 2 o'clock here on ThinkTech. On Center Stage, I talk with artists about not only what they do and how they do it, but the meat of the conversation for me is why they do it, why we go through this. A lot of us are not making our livings doing this, and a lot of us would do this with our last dying breath if we had that choice. And that's what I love to talk to people about. I hope you enjoy watching it, and I hope you get inspired because there's an artist inside you too. Join us on Center Stage at 2 o'clock on Wednesdays. Bye.
Aloha! How you doing? It's me, Angus McTech. Wishing you to welcome and join us to see us on Hibachi Talk on ThinkTech Hawaii. Join my co-hosts, Gordo the Texan, and Andrew the security guy every Friday from 1300 to 1345. We look forward to seeing you. We'll talk tech, and we'll have some wee bit of fun. And remember, let your wing gang free wherever you be. Aloha!
Ah, there we have some drones. Look at that. Drones on the frontier. And a swarm, it looks like. Anyway, so I made a little list, Ethan, of the kinds of things, you know, the drones that we know drones can do. One, cameras.
Right.
And I think cameras, as I said, the NAB show, big deal, big deal. Huge drones, expensive drones. Drones very highly capable. And this kind of technology is being built for cameras, but can be used for other things.
Right.
Okay, disasters. Well, I guess that's cameras too. There are guys, including guys at UH, who go around in the Department of Geography, go around to disasters, and they help people on the ground by giving them an aerial shot of what happened. You could never get there because it's a disaster.
Right.
Though with the drone can tell you what you have and what's cooking and what to do. Agriculture. Mm-hmm. If you want to see how your field is doing in one fell swoop, go right up, take a look, and you can see. And then you can use infrared or ultraviolet, whatever, and you can tell exactly what's going on with the growing plants.
The smart yield folks here are doing
that kind of stuff. Oh, that's good. Yeah. Okay. Glad we're doing that.
Right.
And all this, you really, just footnote to all of this, is you really wonder whether the FAA is keeping up with this. Because, you know, it's very exciting. You can buy drones on the internet. You can buy all kinds of stuff.
One of them gets sucked in the engine of a 747.
It's taking off. It's a real problem.
That's going to be bad. Yeah.
And is the FAA really the right agency for this? I'm not sure it is, because this is so, you know, ubiquitous all around Hawaii and everywhere.
Right.
We're a test site under the FAA regulations, but, you know, I think drones are... really provocative. Everybody wants one for good and commercial reasons.
Sure.
But they're not, the regulation hasn't settled down. Okay, then we got delivery, you know. Just a week ago, Amazon made its first delivery with a drone. They weren't kidding. They only announced this idea a year ago. Now look.
Yeah.
You know?
And that gets us in that whole issue that, that technologies are turning around so fast. The half-life between when a technology is developed and when it gets into widespread circulation is shrinking just so rapidly now.
Yeah.
And yes, probably 3 years ago, no one thought about flocks of drones going places. And now they're out there.
Yeah. You know? And by the way, flocks of cars, too. Autonomous cars.
Right.
Like Google.
Right.
So you can have a highway full of cars that act like a swarm in order to get from A to B. I mean, it's easy, the software, from where we are now. Of course, as I mentioned, weapons, and weapons are, you know, that's the black box. We don't know the kinds of weapons that are being developed here. Mm-hmm. It's not just that we're doing surveillance on the bad guys, but that we can shoot them at it. Shoot them and blow them up with drones that are. And the thing about drones is they don't die. They just fall out of the sky.
Mm-hmm,
it's not a big deal if you lose one.
Right, yeah, exactly.
So that's really creepy. So you don't put anybody in harm's way except the victim. And hopefully you got the victim identified properly. So in terms of the technology, seems to me that within the next year or two or three, because of the huge market for drones, the huge need, you know, for government surveillance and weaponry, we are going to see, you know, incentives to develop technology. For example, material science, those things are this big now.
Mm-hmm.
And A, they'll be lighter.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Something in material science, we'll find some material that makes them lighter and therefore greater range.
Mm-hmm.
B, their engines will be more powerful and therefore faster and higher. And C, their batteries will be better. Batteries are everything now, especially with photovoltaic. You know, everybody wants batteries. So a lot of people are researching batteries and the right composition for batteries. And graphene is a possibility, right? We talked about graphene batteries.
Exactly.
So if we do just those three things, we can get to the others too.
Mm-hmm.
That will change the way drones work, won't it?
Right, right. They will become longer lived, able to do more things, smaller, lighter, therefore cheaper to produce, basically. Yeah. And in a way, that's great because it'll be more and more uses for them that they can do search and rescue for missing people and cover far more ground more effectively than a person could. You equip it with an infrared camera and it can spot a person. You can keep searching during the night. you know, when people, surfers or paddleboarders get lost out in our waters here.
Right, search and rescue.
Send the drones out for them.
Send the drones out, yeah.
You know, drop flares around them to let them know that they've been spotted, you know, radio back, give them the exact position so the boat can come out and rescue them.
Yeah.
Things like if you have a collapsed building, you can get drones that can go inside of it, basically, where you don't have to risk somebody's life climbing through a collapsing structure or a fragile structure. Send in a drone to check out, put different sensor technology on it. It can check for carbon dioxide, or again, have infrared heaters, whatever, to check for, are there survivors? Where are they, you know?
Yeah, there was a movie out. It was about some terrorist thing in the Middle East. So many movies like that. I can't remember the name, but the drone they used for surveillance, for spying, for espionage in advance of an attack, the American drone, was that big. It was mm-hmm. the size of a grasshopper.
Right.
And it really was. I mean, this was not fiction. This was about that big, and it had a camera.
Right.
And it could fly into a building through a window, and mm-hmm. then it could spy on the people. You know, it found a perch, mm-hmm. and it would just sit there and spy on the people and send signals back across the world mm-hmm. with radio technology and internet and all that. So there in Central Asia, you know, the guys in Washington are watching this amazing, yeah?
Yeah, I mean, there's very interesting things as you shrink objects down below some size. They behave very differently aerodynamically. And the scientists have been trying for years to make sort of flying artificial insects, and they're actually now beginning to succeed. You get little tiny things like at that scale to fly.
You know what I find very interesting is the cameras they're using with these drones. And the little ones, I don't know about the big ones. Mm-hmm. Maybe they got bigger cameras. I don't think they need bigger cameras because why? Because the cell phones,
right.
the iPhone and, right. And the Android phones, they got great cameras.
Right.
And I read recently that the iPhone in Apple, there are 800 people on their permanent payroll just refining their cameras. Okay, so it's not a surprise that these drones use cell phone cameras mm-hmm. in order to take their pictures. They're so light, right. so powerful, right. so focused.
They're so mass-produced, they become cheap. You know, again, that's what you want for a drone. It's a lot of cheap stuff that you can stick into it. You know, yeah, absolutely.
So, I mean, this is really, it's really interesting what they can do. And I certainly agree that it's light, and the battery is, a long-lasting battery. You can go much further.
Recharges for solar power as it's in flight. Yeah,
maybe they got another big drone that comes by, and this is like the old bombers, right?
Exactly, with refueling station.
Refueling station. Or, don't forget, you could have better technology in photovoltaic cells, mm-hmm. and you could have it recharging while it's flying.
Exactly.
Just trickle charge.
Right.
So it keeps going a little longer.
Right, yeah.
You know, I mean, remarkable what's possible here. Right. So I think there's going to be all kinds of new uses coming up.
Yeah.
Sensors, for example, they're changing while you watch. They're smaller, they're more powerful.
Yeah, sensors for now for different chemicals you can get. So that, one molecule in trillions, they can pick it out. So again, if you want to start searching for either specific chemicals, as in explosives, traces of explosives that somebody may be carrying, or probably in this day and age, they'll be able to start searching for individuals by smell, right?
Like a dog.
Yeah, exactly.
Just you put the fellow's clothing under the drone, and the drone smells it, and then he goes looking for it.
Exactly.
The funny thing is that the FAA regulations now require individuals, up to this point, require individuals not to lose sight of their drones. I mean, have to have line of sight control on your drone.
Right.
And I mean, that's pathetic. That's just ridiculous. These drones are capable, even now, before the technology is really robust, of flying, miles in seconds.
Right.
Why in the world would you try to limit that? We've got to find a better way to regulate them.
Well, yeah.
They need to be regulated,
of course. You don't want them flying into airports. I mean, that's right. just begging
that's
for trouble.
That's a concern.
If
they can really disrupt an airliner.
Very badly.
And of course, they could be made into weapons that could disrupt an airliner.
With no extra weaponry on them, just flying into an engine.
Yeah.
This is going to...
Would you invest in a company that is building drones? There must be a lot of them around.
I suspect there must be, yeah. And which one? Again, it's sort of like the classic internet problem. There's too much information out there. How do you know who's building the technology that's going to really come out on top?
You did research on the web, you'd find the leaders.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you'd find companies that would sell them to you, with all kinds of technology mm-hmm. that that would surprise you. Mm-hmm. I think there must be a lot of police departments looking for them to surveil cities.
Oh, absolutely.
Cameras are so popular, but this is better than the camera on the light post, because this can, you know, go down and focus.
Rural police departments out in the boonies, a huge boon. Rather having the cop get in his car and drive 40 miles to the little town, just send the drone over there to sort of see what the trouble is, you know?
Yeah, and disposable.
Yeah.
It's like the drone that the, was it the Chinese picked up? Off
underwater
drone.
Yeah.
They picked it up, and the U.S. wanted it back, so the Chinese held it for 3 days and looked at everything, and then they give it back. Smart move, actually.
Yeah, it was.
But can you see in 5-10 years, this is going to be ubiquitous everywhere.
Yeah.
Everybody's going to have them, and regulation will be very difficult. Everybody will add. You know, there was a kid in New England about 6 months ago who outfitted a drone with a gun, and he was flying it around with a gun.
Didn't hear about that.
It's not that hard to do. God knows what can happen now.
So
on Friday, every Friday at 4 o'clock, we have
this where the drone
where
leads.
The drone leads with Ted Ralston, and actually it's already an organization. These guys started it here on ThinkTech like 3 years ago maybe. And after a program we did at a downtown forum about drones, it now has real legs, and is flying high, so to speak. And he has people coming in from all over the country,
flocking in together. Right?
And Hawaii, right. Yeah. So, what would you say to somebody who is in high school or college about whether to get into drones and how you get into drones and how you can be excited by this technology and advance it and have a living, a career off it? There's camera one, Ethan. Tell them what they can do.
Well, again, I mean, the many, many different fields of science that you mentioned at the start suggest huge entry points through engineering, through any sort of science, aeronautics, fuel cells, batteries, solar power, almost any of these ways you can get into this technology and begin to contribute to that field. And yes, I can't help but think that drones are going to be an expanding business opportunity for people around the world, in every country that wants to do things. I mean, their potential to do good is huge. The potential to harm is equally big, but yeah, it'd be a great career choice for a student today.
Yeah, and if you don't want to do drone technology, that's okay. You can do anti-drone technology.